Dreamscape presents Marvel's The X-Men and the Avengers, Gamma Quest, Book 2, Search and Rescue, by Greg Cox. Narrated by Pete Cross. But search the land of living men, where wilt thou find their like again? Sir Walter Scott, 1808. If there are people in need, mutate, mutant, human, or otherwise, the Avengers are there. Steve Rogers, 1993. Prologue. They also serve who only stand and wait. Milton's immortal words came readily to Edwin Jarvis's thoughts as he worriedly watched an emergency news bulletin on television. He often turned to that particular quotation in times of trouble. Indeed, over the course of his long tenure as butler to the mighty Avengers, it had practically become his credo. Alas, that seldom made the waiting any easier. His hands kept busy polishing a silver tea service while his gaze stayed glued to a small television monitor mounted above the kitchen counter. The middle-aged Englishman wore an apron over his starched proper attire. At the moment, he had the spotless kitchen to himself, along with the rest of Avengers Mansion. On the screen overhead, live footage from Niagara Falls revealed that a trio of his superheroic employers were once more pitted against formidable antagonists in a battle of epic proportions. To be more specific, the combined strength and extraordinary abilities of the champion of liberty, Captain America, the high-tech knight, Iron Man, and the synthetic human, the Vision, were now matched against both the notorious outlaw mutants known as the Uncanny X-Men and the fearsome green man-monster called the Incredible Hulk. A daunting combination, the butler assessed, although he clung steadfastly to his faith that the Avengers would emerge triumphant in the end, as they so often had before. They have consistently prevailed over even greater odds, he recalled, and against far more merciless foes. Both the X-Men and the Hulk, in fact, had sometimes fought beside the Avengers as allies, for all that such partnerships tended to be strained and somewhat fractious. Whatever cruel combination of circumstances had led to this present conflict, Jarvis held on to the hope that neither the Hulk nor the X-Men truly desired the Avengers' total destruction, as might say the Grim Reaper or Ultron. Although where the undeniably volatile Hulk was concerned, anything was possible. Nor could such reassurances rule out the possibility of a tragic accident, particularly in so hazardous a setting. The awesome heights of Niagara Falls, over which torrents of frothing white water cascaded impressively, provided a scenic backdrop to the spectacular struggle, but also obvious opportunities for the various combatants to come to harm. Even now, as Jarvis methodically buffed the exterior of a tarnished tea kettle, the Hulk had fearlessly taken up a position along the very crest of the famed Horseshoe Falls, tempting fate, not to mention the raging current, to topple him from his precarious perch. Jarvis gulped involuntarily as the Vision alighted in the rapids above the falls, only a few feet away from the bestial green Goliath known as the Hulk. I certainly hope Master Vision knows what he is doing, Jarvis fretted. Never mind the falls for a moment. On his own, the Hulk could be as savage as he was inhumanly powerful. TV news people speculated shamelessly about what might have brought all these costumed champions to this titanic clash, the reporters' urgent voiceovers accompanying vivid action footage from cameras on the shore. Jarvis turned down the volume. He already knew far more than the commentators about the origins of this latest adventure. It had all started yesterday, when Mistress Wanda, professionally known as the Scarlet Witch, failed to return from a morning's outing to a local museum. Subsequent investigation revealed that the mutant heroine had been attacked and abducted by, of all things, one of the displays of a coterie of wooden marionettes. As though this were not puzzling enough, Iron Man's sophisticated electronic sensors had detected lingering traces of radiation at the site of the Scarlet Witch's disappearance. gamma radiation, to be precise, of the sort associated with both the rampaging Hulk and his more rational alter ego, Dr. Robert Bruce Banner. Led by Captain America, the Avengers had already resolved to seek out the Hulk and/or Banner to question him, them, about the incident at the museum when word came that the SHIELD helicarrier, airborne headquarters of the world's premier intelligence and anti-terrorism organization, had been invaded by several superpowered mutants linked to the X-Men. According to Nicholas Fury, the irascible director of SHIELD, the mutant renegades had stolen the top-secret prototypes of the Gamma Sentinels, a new generation of robot enforcers powered by the same form of gamma radiation that had created the Hulk. Given that the Gamma Sentinels were expressly designed to seek out and contain dangerous mutants, a preemptive strike by the X-Men seemed a plausible explanation for the assault on the helicarrier, even if Captain America continued to entertain doubts about the X-Men's guilt, judging them innocent until proven otherwise, according to the best tradition of British and American justice.
"How very like the Captain to give the X-Men the benefit of the doubt," Jarvis reflected. "But whatever could the stolen Sentinels and the X-Men have to do with Mistress Wanda's abduction, especially since the mutant-hunting robots were purloined several hours after the Scarlet Witch's bizarre encounter with the animated puppets?"
Her avenging teammates had been equally baffled by the peculiar chain of events. Then the evening news had reported that Bruce Banner, a wanted fugitive, had been spotted in Niagara Falls, just south of the Canadian border. The three Avengers on hand, including Mistress Wanda's estranged husband, the Vision, had immediately winged toward Niagara, only to land squarely in the middle of a tense confrontation involving the Hulk, the X-Men, and the armed forces of both the United States and Canada. Precisely whose side the X-Men were on remained unclear to both the on-air commentators and Jarvis himself. At various points in the ongoing crisis, they had appeared to be both allied and opposed to the Hulk, who seemed typically ill-disposed to all concerned. Jarvis did not know the X-Men well, having in the past had but fleeting contact with those of their number, but past encounters with the Hulk led him to suspect that the brutish Hulk was on the side of nothing save yet more chaos and strife. Jarvis had cleaned up after the Hulk enough to know that where that uncouth ogre went, violence and wanton destruction surely followed. But although the faithful butler expected the worst of the Hulk, he was still caught by surprise when the great green monster ripped the Vision's arm from its socket.
"Good heavens!" Jarvis exclaimed.
The teapot slipped from his fingers, landing in a clatter upon the kitchen floor. Telephoto lenses caught an unmistakably human expression of agony upon the synthesoid's sculpted features. A shower of sparks erupted from the Vision's right shoulder. Oily lubricants and hydraulic fluid sprayed from severed tubing as the Vision's head jerked spastically. The amber jewel embedded in his forehead flashed on and off, the solar glow within the gem flickering weakly. Crimson lips whispered some plaintive plea or warning, but all Jarvis could hear was the roar of the falls and the breathless commentary of the stunned newspersons. He watched in horrified silence as the Hulk callously discarded the Vision's crudely amputated limb, hurling it over the edge of the falls. Then the Hulk shoved the Vision, and the tottering synthesoid followed his severed arm over the falls. Jarvis prayed that the Vision would save himself by taking flight, reducing his artificial body's density until it was lighter than air. But instead, the camera tracked his terrifying plunge until the android Avenger vanished into the swirling mists at the bottom. Could even the Vision survive such a precipitous drop? Jarvis hoped for the best, but decided to have the engineering laboratories in the mansion's sub-basement up and running by the time the Avengers returned.
"Perhaps I should alert Dr. Pym as well," Jarvis thought, "and warn him to be on call."
The brilliant scientist, now a reserve member of the Avengers, probably understood the Vision's construction better than any other human on Earth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.